person is. Oh, dear God. Slow me down. Did you want it a little bit more centered this time? I must have already... Oh, no. I must have already...
I was blind, now I'm seeing in color. I was dead, now I'm living forever. I had failed, but you were my redeemer. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I was lost, now I'm found by the Father. I've been changed from a ruined treasure. I've been given a hope and a future. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I am counting every blessing, counting every blessing, letting go and trusting when I cannot see. I am counting every blessing, counting every blessing. Show me every season, you are good to me.
good days, I've had bad days, tasted victory and defeat. I've had problems big as planets, turn to pebbles when you speak. I've had nothing to my name, never lacked for anything, 'cause you were there with me. You've been my savior, sustainer.
With all creation. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Hello, church. Glad you woke up, ready to praise the Lord and worship Him today. You're all looking good. Y'all look pretty. We bought you flowers this morning. Aren't you excited?
Yeah.
Well, actually, we didn't buy them for you. We went up and got them out of the closet. And that's how you're supposed to know where to see it. All right. Let's continue to worship the Lord of all creation.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea.
Some things that are going on in the life of the church. Just a reminder, we had a pretty good Sunday last week. We're still trying to catch up over the shortfall that we've had during COVID. So we really need you to dig deep. And if you weren't able to give during that period of time, just the Lord wants you to catch up with Him. All right. And I just thought I'd show you this how much we've got today. So anyway. So help us out. You can get online, go to our Facebook, to our website, and there's a button there to click on that will take you to a giving page. Or you can put it in the mail if you would dare to do that. Or you could drop it by here during the week or bring it on Sunday. All right. However you want to do, it's fine.
Don't forget that we have prayer time on Tuesday at 1 o'clock, Facebook Live. He zings us ahead of time, and we are ready to pray. We take prayer requests, and we have a good time to pray together every Tuesday afternoon at 1 o'clock on Facebook Live, so join us there and be excited there. And whether you do the Facebook Live or not, join us on Thursday evening at 7 o'clock where we are Zooming into God's Word. It's really kind of cool. If you haven't tried doing the Zoom meetings yet, we get to talk interactively. It's like a FaceTime call for you iPhone people. And we're starting a new lesson this time. We've finished up with the parables, and we're starting with distinctive theologies this Thursday. So brand new lesson. second lesson series, Thursday, 7 o'clock, Zoom. Pastor always puts out an email, so you've got the where it is. And it's really cool because you read your email, it's blue, you click on it, and you're up on the Zoom. You don't have to do any other steps. So join us there. Also, next Sunday, our crisis care kits are due. And we got all of our bags taken last week. Several people gave gave money and put in the bags. But then we had the bags taken out. So if you took a bag or if you'd like to add an extra crisis care kit, contact us. We'll let you know what the stuff is. But they are all due next Sunday so we can have them down to the general district in a while. I'm seeing something out of the corner of my eye.
Hey, thank you, Mommy.
Hey, how are you?
Well, I think I'm okay. What's she doing?
Oh, I'm sitting up here talking.
Ah, well, I'm so glad that everybody came today for our exercise class. And we're going to practice our spiritual disciplines today, our spiritual exercises. So everybody get ready. First, we're going to do some stretching. All right, get it all stretched out. There you go. Y'all get me. All right. Now, I think we remember we're going to do some of our exercises, our spiritual exercises, and we start with push-ups. Y'all ready?
I'm not dressed.
Y'all ready?
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Ready? Here we go. Here we go.
Come on, Mortimer, you can do it.
Okay, that's enough of that one. Now, we're going to do some sit-ups. Y'all ready?
Yes.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Y'all can eat your Wheaties this morning. Or else you got duct tape over your lips. Okay, we're gonna do some sit-ups. Here we go. What?
So.
You don't think so? What spiritual disciplines, you know, exercises that make us spiritually strong. So we do it at church, right?
Not exactly.
Well, what is a spiritual discipline, Miss Callis?
Well, how about praying?
Praying?
Yes.
Oh, I do that all the time.
Well, that's a spiritual discipline.
Really?
Yes.
So I did this whole workout for nothing.
No.
It might have made your heart stronger.
Well, I can't tell. Anyway, so you mean stuff like going to churches and reading the Bibles and that kind of stuff?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, I do all that already. So, okay. Well, thanks y'all for coming to my exercise class anyway. And I know the folks at home couldn't tell, but as bad as I was at it, y'all didn't do anything.
There are days when the pain is a lot to carry. And the ones who are supposed to love you end up hurting you the most. And everything inside you wants to run, to hide, to escape. And sometimes that's how you cover the pain. But that's not how scars work. They run deep. And so you pretend everything's okay. But the pain doesn't stop. I think pretending just makes it worse. Until you realize you're not alone. Other people are broken too. And they need someone to help. Someone who knows what it feels like, who's walked through it. The pain can scar you, but it also changes the way you look around yourself, at the world, at people. No one's too broken for grace. That's what makes it grace.
Let's bow in prayer together. Father, we are grateful for the privilege to come and worship together with God's people. Thank you again, Lord, for the miracle of technology, that we can come together even though we are apart. Thank you for grace. Grace that carries us through. And thank you that you have chosen to love us and to be involved in the everyday of our lives, not because we've deserved it, not because we've earned your attention, but simply because you love us.
Amen.
And it is your volitional choice to be involved in our world. You're not a God who sits aloof up on the throne of heaven and keeps a world under your thumb or watches ambivalently as the world carries on. But you left your throne and you came and lived as a man, took on the role of a slave, and lived in perfect obedience to the will of the Father that took you all the way to the cross, where you suffered and bled and died for humankind. And because of your obedience, the Father has chosen to glorify himself through you. And he gave you the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee would bow and every tongue would confess. You are an awesome God. We love you today. Lord, we have so many in need today. I pray for Miss Sarah. She anticipates surgery. Brenda, as she also anticipates surgery this week and now is dealing with a poor poison ivy outbreak. Pray for the many special needs, Lord, in our church family. Miss Karen, as she continues to deal with her fall from last week. Deborah's niece, David's family, and the list just goes on and on. Pray your blessings on Miss Frances, Lord. Continue to strengthen her and keep her in your loving arms. Thank you for those who care for her. You're an awesome God. And I know there are others that we've not given mention today. We're thankful, Lord, that you know each one. Lift Thelma to you, God. She deals with her back break and, Lord, the severe pain that she experiences. And you know, we could just go on and on. There are so many needs in our church family and in our world of which you are fully aware.
Amen.
And you are the God of power. Again, the one who chooses to come and embrace us with your presence.
Yes,
Lord, I pray that you would heal our land. Heal us from division, O God. Help us to look beyond ourselves and look to the other person with respect and compassion. Lord, be with our president. Continue to strengthen him and grant to him wisdom. And I pray that you continue, Lord, to lift up the church. May we rise up and be your voice in this time of upheaval across our land. And we give you praise and glory for who you are. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I enjoy the rain. I like to watch it patter on the pavement and on the ground and in the trees, and to watch it dance on the leaves. I like the smell that it brings to the air, and I really like the sound of a gentle rain that relaxes me. And there's another kind of rain that I enjoy. That's the reign of Jesus Christ in my life. There was a day that he only reigned over my Sunday mornings. But as I grew in my faith and deepened in my relationship with him and my understanding of him, gradually I gave him access to every area of my life. My money, my relationships, my future, my career, which now is a ministry, and even access to and reigning over my everyday decisions. There is something so very freeing when Jesus Christ reigns in a person's life. Over the next few Sunday mornings, we're going to be talking about the reign. We're going to consider what it means when Christ is sovereign in a person's life, and when he is sovereign over the entire world, how that impacts us, and the fact that one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So I hope you will join us on these Sunday mornings. Join us on Facebook or here at the church as we worship together and consider the reign. God bless you. I look forward to seeing you.
The rain. It's a pretty sunshiny day out there today, isn't it? A beautiful day. But it's still raining in my heart. How about yours? You know, people who only have a casual relationship with God also have an extremely limited understanding of God. Not that any of us really understand the Almighty, but the deeper we experience him, the better we can accept his ways and affirm his omnipotence. And that's the question that we're going to begin with today as we talk about the reign. See, the shallow believer will wonder why God doesn't get more involved in our world, especially when things like COVID-19 happen, or when protesters go to the extreme and violate the laws and the law enforcers. They may be the ones who are asking why innocent people suffer. And the ultimate thought, the deeper issue for those people is that either God is too weak or we are really strong. And if that's what a person believes, that God's too weak or too ambivalent to care, you know what the next step is? They take matters of life into their own hands as though God can't make it without our help. Rather than thinking of man's weakness and God's strength, which is really at the heart of this whole series, instead they turn around and boast of their own strength and complain about God's weakness. So what does it mean to say that God is omnipotent? Or to use the biblical term, that God is almighty. Many people take that to mean that God can do anything. You and I know technically that's not true. He can't sin. He can't stop loving you. He can't create something or someone more powerful than himself. And omnipotence is a part of his nature. Omnipotence as a noun isn't even found in Scripture. The adjective omnipotent appears, except for one time, it only appears in John's Revelation. One writer wrote it like this: in God resides the power to produce and control everything that comes to pass. Nothing evades God's omnipotence, and even the most minute things, such as the falling sparrow or the hairs of our head, are under his personal control. And there is nothing accidental or incidental, and the thought of omnipotence easily then merges with omnipresence and omniscience. So when we talk about his omnipotence, he can't do anything that is self-contradictory or anything that is contradictory to his own nature. Intellectual tricks, you know, raising questions like, can God create something so big that he can't pick it up? You know, that's not even a valid question. The person who would ask a question like that isn't taking seriously the idea of God's omnipotence. Now, they think they have his corner. Either he can't create it or he can't lift it. Either way, I got you. There's something God can't do. Well, there are some things God can't do, but that in and of itself isn't even a right way to think. He can in no way contradict his own nature by sinning or by dying. He can't make wrong things right, or he can't make wrong right. He can't pretend that what has happened has not happened. See, the power of God implies the power of self-limitation. That's one of the most important keys to understanding God's omnipotence, yet most people overlook it. Part of God's omnipotence is that he can limit himself. He is not subject to internal or external compulsion, and he has power over his power. So when we think about, for example, Jesus on the cross, he had the power to save himself. Somebody asked me when I was a professor, when I was in college, could Jesus have saved himself and gotten down off the cross? Well, physically, yes, I think he could have. But he can't contradict his nature, and his nature is love, and his nature is obedience to the Father. So in that sense, he couldn't. He could not have saved himself from the cross because it would have contradicted who he is. And so he has power over his power, which is always under his holy will and his control, under his wisdom. Well, in this series of sermons on the rain, we're going to look at four R's. That's not A-R-E, that's not O-U-R-S, countryfied R's. That's R's, how about y'all's? Yeah. It's the letter R. Each of these four elements are going to begin with the letter R. And I want to be sure that you get those. But the reign of God in my life begins with my resolve to allow him access to every aspect of my life. So today's word is resolve. Part of his omnipotence is that he made man in such a way that man can choose to rebel against God and set up his own world that functions in opposition to the Almighty. That's how it began in the Garden of Eden. It began with the temptation and then man's option to choose either God's way or his own way. And you know that man chose to disregard the way of God and chose his own way instead. Well, if God was omnipotent, he could have made man follow his ways. That's not even part of omnipotence. That's omniscience, all right? But anyway, a whole other story. God, if he had done that, it would have contradicted his nature. So he couldn't do that. We said that God's omnipotence means that he has power over his power. And the freedom to choose in the garden is the same freedom to choose today, that God continues to allow. He does not overpower his power to allow us freedom to choose. But there is a rub here pertaining to the Almighty. You got to get this, because it's almost comical. Even if we choose to go our own way and create our own world, God still exists there. If you decide, well, I'm just going to be my own man, I'm going to follow my own plan. You know what? God's going with you. He's still going to be with you even though you're following your own way. You've shunned him, but he doesn't leave. He knows that. It reminds me of the old country song, you know. How can I miss you if you don't leave? How can I miss you if you're not gone, if you're still here? God's still here. No matter what you choose. And he knows that man, here's the catch. Now, this is the rub. He knows that man can never be fully satisfied in a world of his own devising. Did you get that? Until your ways follow his way, and until you've allowed him not only access, but total reign in every area of your life, you will not be fully satisfied. Did you get it? Even if you're building your own world and following your own plan.
So you're really...
Check it out, aren't you?
You want more proof? I haven't done the pillar of salt thing in a while.
That's all right. I believe you. I don't understand why you chose me.
You want to change the world, son. So do I.
What? Why an ark? I mean, that's like flood territory. You wouldn't do that again. You wouldn't do that. Would you do that?
Let's just say that whatever I do because I love you.
Well, then you have to understand that this whole building an ark thing is really not part of my plans here. I need to settle into my house. I need to make a good impression at work. What?
Your plans. That's
What are you talking? We're talking about an ark, right? I mean, an ark? An ark is huge. I don't even know where I would begin.
Al, I hear that a lot. People want to change the world, don't know how to begin. You want to know how to change the world, son? One act of random kindness at a time.
Build the ark. I'll tell you what. You build it, I'll fill it. And if anybody asks, tell them flood's coming. Oh, and you might need this.
Okay, so what do? I grab the wood and then... Oh, okay. You know, that's just cruel. Do you see him? I don't see him.
Building an ark the old-fashioned way. God is the creator of the heavens and the earth. He lives in all things and has over 6,700,000,000 children.
Now, I think God has the power to stifle his laugh. I don't think he would actually laugh at us. But when we inform him that we've got a plan of our own, it must be comical to him to think that something that we could devise for our own life is better than what he could come up with for us. And then... as it said, the clip said right there at the end. He is involved. He is in every living thing. Every living thing. And so the Bible is clear that we not only have the ability to choose, but we have the responsibility to choose wisely. And the only rule of living, aren't you glad there aren't a big old long list of rules? The only rule for living well is for men to regulate themselves completely by the law of God. And his law is love. The psalmist prayed in Psalm 119, prayed that the Lord would order his steps. Have you ever prayed that? I pray it often. And he's speaking of that whole psalm, Psalm 119, is a psalm uplifting the Word of God. And the Word is speaking of order his steps, is speaking of regulating or directing or governing his steps. And so when you come to the place that you are ready, it doesn't bother you that you're asking someone to tell you where to go, when to go, how to go, why to go. See, the first verse of that psalm says, blessed are those who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed, happy, satisfied are those who walk in God's law. And the psalmist was one of those who did that. His steps were in the word of the Lord. And his walk was regulated by the teachings of Scripture. But his steps were to continue to be in the word of God. And if that's so, he needed the Lord to exercise a kind of controlling influence over those steps. You and I need that. If we are walking in the law of God, we need him to have influence over our lives. We need him to reign so that he will order our steps and we will continue to submit to him as he governs our life. And if he tried to order his steps on his own, a man would falter. And the psalmist knew that the enabling and keeping power of God in life was necessary if he was going to stay the course of living for God. And order my steps indicates that it's a one step at a time process. Oh, yes, God, I want you to order my life, but I know that, and I know that you are, but I don't see tomorrow. I don't even see this afternoon, and I know that the next step I'm to take is in this very moment, and I'm taking it. And Lord, I pray that when it comes for me to take my next step, that you will order that step. And the step after that, that you will order that step. And you will keep me in that line. And the only way, folks, that I can live under that kind of reign, the only way that I can live under God's omnipotence is in the context of his other attributes, you know, his omnipresence, his omniscience, the fact that he is absolutely trustworthy, that he's holy and immutable and infinite, and the list just goes on and on. And those are the reasons that I can trust his omnipotence, because I know that everything he does for my good, or as the clip said, everything he does because he loves us. You know, after the resurrection, and Jesus had appeared to the apostles, and Thomas was pleading, I wish I had the same chance you guys had to see him in person. I mean, if I could just see him and touch him, and then the Lord himself, the risen Lord, appeared before Thomas. And I don't know if you ever caught this, but Thomas never touched him. You know, remember Thomas said, if I could just touch him. And when Jesus stood before him and said, here I am, see my scars, my wounds. And Thomas didn't touch him. He instead responded, my Lord and my God. Interpreted means my King, my Lord, the one who reigns over me. And the apostles preached the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Now, I'm going to make a little connection here, and then we're going to wrap it up. So don't miss this, all right? We think about going to heaven. You have to be saved to go to heaven, right? You have to be converted or reborn. You have to be repent and forgiven of your sins. But the word Savior occurs only two times in the Acts of the Apostles. Did you know that? But the title Lord appears 92 times. It says to me that If I want to go to heaven, did I follow Romans 10:9 that says that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved? It has nothing to do with practicing your spiritual disciplines. It has to do with declaring with your mouth and with your life that Jesus Christ is Lord. Now, I can't get into a discussion right now. It's not the time. I can't say that if you're not completely sold out, you're not going to make it. But look at this verse. If you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. So let me ask you this morning one question. Have you resolved the question of who is Lord in your life? Lord of your marriage? Who is Lord of your family? Who is Lord of your career? Who is Lord of your bank account? Who is Lord of your church? Because if we're going to talk about the reign, the Lord reigning in your life, it necessarily begins with giving yourself fully to him and relinquishing control from you to him. If he's going to reign, you've got to let him sit in the pilot seat. Have you resolved that question yet? Heavenly Father, today I thank you for your word, and I pray for every person under the sound of my voice, and more importantly, under the moving of your Holy Spirit, that we would come to truly see and understand that our ways pale in comparison to what you have for us. Amen. And if we could only see that, if we could only understand that our ideas and our plans and our ambitions fall so much farther short than what you would will for our lives. I think every person who would come to understand that would relinquish control. But I confess that most of us, if not all of us, from time to time just can't help picking up the controller again. We get into a spot in our lives and without even realizing it, we've started calling the shots in a particular issue, a circumstance we're facing. But I thank you that your Holy Spirit is quick to remind us. Show us what we've done and give us the faith to consecrate again every aspect to you. And my prayer, and I trust it's the prayer for every person worshiping with us today, let your reign be and continue in me. Amen. Good to be with you this morning. Thanks for joining us in this time of worship. We're going to close with a song on video. The lyrics are not showing, but listen to the message of this song. It's so powerful. It's titled, You've Always Been. It's talking to God. No matter where you go in your life, no matter where you've been in your life, he's always been with you. Amen. He's always been there. God bless you. Have a great day.
Good days, I've had bad days, tasted victory and defeat. problem.